Question: what is the difference between a PC and a game console? When I ask that, I'm not referring to the argument PC gamers and console gamers have been screaming at each other for decades, although we all know board games beat both of them. I mean from a technology perspective, because when you think about it, it's not really a one-to-one comparison. PCs are made for general use. They can play games, but they're also for a more broad variety of things. And the operating system it runs typically needs to be extremely robust to accommodate all of those use cases. A console, however, doesn't need all that. It's primarily an entertainment device. Make it play games, add some streaming services on there, boom, it's good to go. Because of that, it's naturally much more restrictive. Certain concerns a PC user might have, a console user wouldn't even think about. Malware is one of them. Not only is it harder to write malware for such a limited device, but there's exponentially less to gain from it. Nobody's sharing government secrets over PictoChat after all. I hope. Maybe you'll get lucky and find some financial information or some account passwords for your misguided efforts, but even then you're targeting a user base much smaller and much harder to exploit than just hijacking one of like a billion Windows machines. For someone to even entertain the idea of video game malware, you'd have to be some weirdo who really likes to waste time learning about things that nobody cares about to do completely pointless things that nobody asked for. Hey there, nice to meet you. Yep, this video is about console malware. I think it's a really interesting topic that gets overlooked a lot because examples are very scarce. And the general taboo around it means that misinformation and stuff like that is everywhere. Luckily, that's my favorite kind of topic to cover. We're gonna be going over the ways that things have been destroyed, information has been stolen, and lives have been ruined. All because someone wanted to play a video game. That was probably way too dramatic, but hey, it feels like that sometimes when you lose a 100-hour save file. But because of the lack of reason to make these things, I feel like there's a lot of missed potential that a particularly evil person could have taken advantage of throughout the years of gaming. So, for just one video, let's be evil. While we examine these things, we're gonna be looking for ways to improve upon the methods used. If we had all the information of today, and a hypothetical, all too trusting friend who bought their system day one, how much havoc could we cause? Plus, it gives me the chance to try this new format I've been workshopping for a while. Still can't control the face, but maybe it'll read the room well enough. Hopefully it turns out well. Feel free to let me know what you think about it in the comments. But without further ado, welcome to Tech Rules. But first, a huge thanks to Morning Brew for sponsoring today's video. A daily, free newsletter that catches you up on business, finance, and tech news in just 5 minutes. Part of the appeal of technology is that it's always changing. What was the standard in a field 1 month might be entirely outdated the next, and I can't emphasize how important it is to stay on top of these constantly changing trends, breakthroughs, and countless other things. And unfortunately, keeping up with stuff like business and what's current follows similar themes. This was something to juggle on top of my video research for Tech Rules, and it led to the same issues I had of chasing vague sources, contacting people for clarifications on scarcely documented events, and figuring out which of these sources are even important enough for me to spend my time on. But thanks to Morning Brew, a significant chunk of that is delivered straight to me in a format that's trivially easy to fit into my morning routine. And to top it off, the information is presented in a fun and engaging way, instead of just the mind-numbing info dumps you're probably used to. For example, did you know that, like, 26 words were added to the Oxford English Dictionary because of how big Korean media and culture has gotten for us? That's wild. I never would have discovered this if it weren't for the newsletter, despite the fact that stuff like this is super interesting to me. Needless to say, I highly recommend you subscribe to Morning Brew. Even if you're not particularly interested in business, but just have a passing interest in its goings-on, I feel like you'll really appreciate it. Like I said, it's free, and it takes less than 15 seconds to subscribe. Click the link in the description below to subscribe to Morning Brew today. Anyway, on to the video. First things first, we need to clarify exactly what we're targeting. The whole point of this video is to highlight cases of malware and devices where they would be impractical to show up. That means we should avoid anything that's too much like a PC or too much like a smartphone. Handhelds are fair game though, as long as they match what we're looking for. Devices used almost exclusively for gaming, with very closed off and restrictive operating systems. Things that you would never see operating erratically and think, uh-oh, time to run a scan. Even with this description, however, the advancement of technology is constantly changing the, you know, expectations of what a console can do. I'm gonna try to keep that in mind and give the earlier consoles the attention they deserve, even if examples for them were a little more scarce. With that in mind, I guess our first stop will be the first, well, first, set of mainstream consoles. We're talking about the Magnavox Odyssey, to the various Ataris, all the way up to stuff like the N64. Why am I bunching up all these consoles? Well, when we're trying to come up with these hypothetical situations where we'd needlessly destroy things, we have to analyze what's actually accessible to destroy. The simpler the system, the less entry points we'll have to exploit. And these simple cart-based systems typically have none whatsoever. Like, let's look at what we got here. There's a console, there's a game, you put the game in the console, power the console on, from there the system immediately passes it over to the game, and that's the state we're in until it's powered off. Everything's just too self-contained here. Even if we put something villainous into the cart, there's nothing that we could really do with that. Unless you consider displaying terrifying secrets on the screen to traumatize children as doing something, personalized copies of beloved games aside. Even if we did manage to run our code without restriction, the worst we could do is just erase the save files. I'd take that though. For some games, that would be nothing short of devastating. Even if it's not very powerful, it's still somewhat petty. I'm cool with petty, but I wanted more. So I tried to figure out another way. Our primary issue here is that there's no way to cross things over, right? Only one game can be loaded at a time. Well, this solution is gonna sound stupid, but if that's the case, why don't we just find a way to load more than one game? I'm gonna call this approach Save Corruption and Knuckles. I'm not just being dumb when I say that. I mean, okay, I'm being dumb when I say that, but there's a reason I'm calling it that. This approach is literally the idea behind the game Sonic and Knuckles. It had a slot at the top for another Genesis game, allowing it to use code from the game to create new experiences. That wasn't the first iteration of this kind of system. There were obviously cheating devices, and notably bootleg NES games that used a real NES game to bypass the system's legitimacy checks. But unlike those devices, this was a big game. It sold like a million copies. And if we were to, say, make a fake Sonic and Knuckles cart with the intention of sneaking some malicious code in there, it's possible some unsuspecting individual would buy it, attach it to their copy of Sonic 3, and now we can erase all of their save data. This is such a pathetic idea. We'd have to go through the trouble of not only somehow manufacturing this device, but we'd have to make it look identical enough to the real thing to pass it off to a reseller or something. And if the stars align and someone buys this thing and uses it, we could delete a Sonic 3 save file. That's it. We have to think about the user's willingness to put games in this thing. You'll have a hard time getting someone to attach a random cart to their beloved games. The idea of tricking the consumer into helping you exploit them is actually a really important aspect of nearly any piece of malware. The catch-all term for it would be social engineering. The first step to many of the most widespread worms in history were, more often than not, clicking an email from someone you thought to be one of your friends. No matter how genius your code is, it'll never steal as many cards as that pesky Nigerian prince. To make this piggyback card idea work, we need help from the victim. And unless you can convince someone that not only is Chrono Trigger and Knuckles a thing, but it's such an amazing improvement to the gameplay that they need to try it on their 20-hour save file, we're not doing much damage. The best approach here would honestly be imitating a cheating device, like the Game Genie or Game Shark. But that's not really necessary, since those devices can be malicious enough anyway. After all, many of the codes people ended up using with this thing were often found randomly on the internet or in a codebook, where you just kinda have to hope it's been tested well enough. All things considered, making a fake code that corrupts the player's save data would be very feasible. So feasible, in fact, that official codes from GameShark themselves have already done my job for me. It wasn't exactly save corruption, but a certain Donkey Kong 64 infinite health cheat works as advertised at first glance. Whenever you turn the codes off, however, you'll find that your maximum health has been permanently changed to 1. One shot now kills you. This is a change to the save file itself, so it's permanent unless you could somehow put together a code to repair the mistake. Guess what kind of code wasn't on the GameShark by default. I think, ultimately, the cart thing is gonna be really hard to pull off, so I wasn't satisfied. The hip freaked out. So I wasn't satisfied with this either. I was thinking, there has to be some way to transfer this data in a less intrusive way. And then it hit me. I realized that the thing I was describing was essentially stop and swap. The idea here would be to take advantage of the system's onboard RAM. Quick explanation for those unfamiliar, RAM stands for Random Access Memory. Consoles need a way to quickly access game data at speeds that just pulling it from the cart can't provide. RAM exists for this reason. The game data goes into the RAM, at which point it can be accessed extremely quickly. When you change areas in a video game and get hit with a loading screen, that typically means the data from that area is being discarded in the RAM to introduce new data for a new area. That's a huge oversimplification, but it's really all you need to know for this idea. The reason I bring up Stop and Swap, the scribed feature intended to send Banjo-Kazooie items to and from other Rareware games, is because that's exactly how it was supposed to work. The N64 was able to retain data in the RAM for around 10 seconds, I think? So the idea was to store data in RAM that the other games could read, allowing you to take items you've collected in one game and move them to another game. If that interests you, there are a ton of videos about it. You should watch one. It's a really cool feature, even if it did get canned. However, there's something interesting about this a lot of people don't seem to think about, and that's when the feature was actually canned. I believe that the letter from Nintendo that requested Stop and Swap be removed happened during the development of Donkey Kong 64. At this time, Banjo-Kazooie was already released, so that game's side of the Stop and Swap programming should be fully functional. And it actually is. Unfortunately, however, there's not much you can do with it. At startup, Banjo-Kazooie checks a very specific portion of RAM for data left over by what was supposed to be other Stop and Swap games. The extent of that check is literally just, do we give the player access to any Stop and Swap items? And that's it. If you were to make some sort of N64 homebrew that writes the correct data to RAM and then boot up Banjo-Kazooie, Stop and Swap should theoretically work perfectly as intended, provided you don't actually have one of the later N64 revisions that held onto the data in RAM for a much shorter period of time. That seemed like a good way to cause some havoc when I thought about that. Like, instead of just putting in a simple string of data that the game just checks, what if we were to put actual executable code in there? Like, there's still the obstacle of how to make the other games run that code, but it's worth looking into, right? Well, I did look into it. And it's mostly a dead end. Obviously, the fact that the N64 stored RAM was a known feature of the system. I say that in air quotes because it's more of a flaw than anything. Obviously, you don't really want random data polluting the code of your game. That can cause all sorts of weird things to happen. Really, the only time you'd want the RAM to have random data in is if you were doing some sort of weird RNG system or like a legitimacy check to make sure the device wasn't being emulated or something. So, most games in the N64 library would actually just clear the RAM entirely on boot up. Even if we were to put some executable code in RAM, it would just get wiped before we even had the chance to do anything. However, most isn't all. And when I was doing the research for this, I was not expecting to find an example of that at SGDQ 2021's Paper Mario Speedrun. Paper Mario is one of the limited amount of games in the N64's library that does not clear the N64 RAM when the game starts up. It also does not look like that. That would be The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time. Ocarina of Time is a game popular with speedrunners for not only having really consistent setups that allow you to quickly pull off extremely precise tricks, but doing this to the point of being able to perform all sorts of game-breaking glitches like wrong warps, item manipulation, and most recently, stale reference manipulation, or SRM. This opens the gate for arbitrary code execution. One day I will be brave enough to tackle an arbitrary code execution speedrun on Tech Rules, but today is not that day. The only thing you really need to know for now is that speedrunners can write data to certain objects in unintended ways, allowing them to directly modify the code that's already been loaded into the RAM. Yeah, if you've not been following speedruns for a bit, this is where we are now. Reprogramming the game. Usually the end goal here is just to make something warp you to the credits, but this one's different. You see, Paper Mario has a glitch that, if done in a very specific way, makes the game try to run code from a section in RAM that only exists if you have an expansion pack in your N64. Since Paper Mario doesn't use the expansion pack, the data is never touched by the game otherwise. So if you were to, say, use OOT to put some instructions in there that would cause Paper Mario to jump to the credits, you could then theoretically stop and swap to Paper Mario, perform the glitch to jump to that portion of memory, and beat the game faster than you ever could without the help of Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time. I promise you, however crazy this looks from an outside perspective, I guarantee you it's 1,000 times more impressive from an inside one. The pieces of the puzzle that had to line up perfectly to make this happen, along with the individuals clever and creative enough to find the connection using the unbelievable amount of game knowledge speedrunners and reverse engineers have accumulated over the years, this is why I've always been so obsessed with stuff like this. Like, I don't know how else to put it. Tech Rules. You should watch that video sometime. But I know, it's not inherently malicious, just something that was used to beat a game faster. But it doesn't have to be. I just wanted to point out that we could use the same idea to erase save data of a different game, provided we can convince someone to do it. I would talk a little more about that idea, but I'm sure some of you are getting real tired of hypotheticals. Let's move on to actual examples, intentional or not. As we get into the disc era of console games, the potential for destruction comes a lot easier. Save files before this point were typically managed by placing a battery in the cartridge, which meant that every game was in charge of its own data. With discs, obviously, you can't do that, so you needed a more centralized form of storage. This led to its own issues, however, since the more games you play, the more space you'll need for save data. And that's the reason that memory cards existed. Now the problem is in the consumer's hands. If they run out of space, they either make space or just buy a completely new one, typically directly from the console's manufacturers. Well, not directly, but you know what I mean. That's an automatic in for us. We still have the problems of firmware typically being a very set-in-stone kind of thing, but your precious save file for your 300-hour RPG? that might just be fair game. The only thing we'd need is a way for our game to access save files other than our own. As it so happens, that's a straight-up feature of memory cards. You can see it in action with a lot of games, where having a save file from one game gives you benefits of another. And of course, it's the entire reason Psycho Mantis knows what games you're playing. Unless he's actually psychic, of course, but you know, what are the odds of that? I can't actually think of any consoles that restrict the data you can read. In other words, as long as we have some way to run our code, we can just wipe the entire memory card. That would obviously involve some form of homebrew, but many of the consoles at this time could run homebrew just fine, to the point where unofficial games could easily enter the market. The Dreamcast was notable, in fact, for being able to run whatever you want off of a regular CD-ROM thanks to the MilCD exploit. Because of this, there isn't much stopping us from writing our own bootleg software, tricking users into running it, and completely wiping their save data. This seems like a glaring oversight on the part of the console manufacturers, but it's not really their problem. In most cases, it's kind of hard to accidentally play an unauthorized game, and if you're playing an unauthorized game, I would imagine most of the manufacturers didn't really care about what that leads to. Unless it's like piracy or something. But otherwise, whatever happened at that point was kind of your fault, at least in their eyes. Since these games had to be officially licensed, there wasn't really a worry that a game would maliciously take advantage of this freedom. That turned out to be somewhat true. They didn't intentionally. If we're talking unintentionally, however, then yeah, existing games have already done the job for me. Now, granted, many examples of this were at least still slightly due to the user doing something they weren't supposed to. A really common one was Super Smash Bros. Melee, actually. If you had Melee in an action replay or something, then you've probably checked out the debug menu the developers left in the game. Since this is a developer-only menu, it's not very user-friendly, as showcased if you go into the Yoshiki menu. Nearly all of these buttons do something to your memory card, and naturally, there's no warning. Special shout-out to the format button there, which many kids who didn't know what that word meant had unfortunately pressed. One A press on this thing, and your entire memory card in slot A is formatted. Every single save file in that thing, gone. Whoops. Now, maybe you're not a cheater, you just want to play the games legitimately using the hardware that you bought from your local stores. Too bad, your files are still in danger, because bootleg PS2 memory cards were still sold there. Tale as old as time, consumers say, "I had a really bad experience with your product, can you do something about that?" Manufacturers say, "Sorry, can't help, you should have bought things directly from us and you wouldn't have triggered the traps we left behind for this specific situation." We can guarantee your data's safe, but only if you use entirely official hardware. And then Capcom says, "Hey, watch this." Of course, I'm talking about the PlayStation Underground Holiday 2004 demo disc. It was a collection of demos designed to grab your attention and secure sales, and it definitely grabbed attention, but not in a good way. This particular disc contained a demo for Beautiful Joe 2, which, as many demos did back then, had a hard timer before the game was supposed to kick you out. It was 20 minutes, I think. Well, for whatever reason, hitting that 20-minute limit wouldn't take you to the normal thanks for playing screen that most demos did. It looks like it just sort of locks up, but what it does behind the scenes is it quite literally completely wipes your memory cards in slots A and B at the time. Sony was very quick to send out emails letting people know that when they received the disc, not to use it with memory cards connected. Didn't really help the people who had already received it, though. The explanation they gave was supposedly that it was some sort of bug, but I think it makes more sense that this was just some function of their developer build that they somehow overlooked. Demos back then were often quickly thrown together using whatever debug build they currently had. It's probably 100% intentional, just overlooked. Which I guess is still technically a bug, whatever. Still kind of blows me away that nobody noticed. They probably got rid of one function that did the format and didn't realize there was a second one on reset. Speculation. Kind of makes our job a little harder though. Wiping all of your save data over playing a demo is something much more evil than I probably could have come up with. I think, for this tier of consoles, we're gonna have to do a little more damage than just destroying save files. What about destroying games? No, I was already beaten to the punch on that one as well. And this one is actually intentionally malicious, to an extent. Let's take a look at the happy, chill, fun world of Animal Crossing Wild World, and the people who decided that they needed to go around and make children cry. There's an item in the game that's used to generate your town at the beginning of the game. These items are dropped at certain coordinates and turned into buildings, trees, and various other things when they're loaded into these locations. While typically inaccessible, you can use a cheating device to put these items in your inventory. You can even physically drop them somewhere in your town and spawn in these structures, just like the game does. Without limits. Now you may be thinking to yourself, who cares? That's just something you can go out of your way to do to yourself, and it's entirely your fault if you screw up your own town because of it. Yes. but who said we had to screw up our town specifically? Because the DS was the first Nintendo console that really tried to push online play. It used the friend code system that many remember from the Wii, but it's not like that really ever stops anyone from connecting with strangers. Friend codes were posted publicly on message boards all the time, you didn't have to look very far. So here's our game plan. We have a copy of Animal Crossing, some sort of cheating device, a modern internet connection, and a cruel heart. Literally all we have to do is get one of these items in our inventory, travel to an unsuspecting player's town, and drop them wherever you think would be the most destructive. This was such an easy and accessible way of griefing that it became an actual problem online users had to watch out for. The act of placing these items onto someone's town was nicknamed seeding, because of how it made things just seemingly pop out of the ground. And it made players very cautious about randomly interacting with each other. Since seeds are invisible unless they transform into the structure, it's hard to notice that someone has seeded your town until you've already saved and it's too late to just quit the game before the change is permanent. The last thing you want while you're trying to play your chill town management game is making sure that the rando you've brought in isn't trying to literally destroy it. This is already bad enough. It's a malicious way to destroy saves in a game primarily about long-term progress. But it's worse than that, because there are no limits to how many seeds can be placed in a town. Put enough down in one spot or in some sort of way the game isn't designed to handle, and that's more than likely going to cause a crash. The risk of crashing reveals a fatal problem, one that can't be recovered from with conventional means. Let's say some absolute monster, such as myself, used seeds to completely destroy my town, to the point where simply trying to load into the town completely locked up the game. That's unfortunate, I spent a lot of time there, but I guess there's nothing more to do than destroy this town and start anew. Except, you can't. Like with every Animal Crossing game, Wild World's title screen features your villagers hanging out in the background, giving you a sort of peek into what they've been doing while you were gone. To actually delete your save file, you would need to use a button combination on this exact screen to get into the town management menu. With the game completely crashing at the title screen, there's no way to delete the save data in-game. Without the use of a cheating device or a save editor, my copy of Animal Crossing is effectively unplayable. This is very close to being as bad as it gets. An accessible exploit that you can use to destroy the games of players you specifically target. I think the only thing that could have been worse was destroying the entire console itself. But I guess that's what happens when you're trying to make online play work on your system for the first time. And it's not like their online features haven't gone through significant changes since then. You could argue it's worse now. For the record, there were claims that this Wild World exploit could destroy systems, but I don't buy it. It makes no sense for that to happen, and there's been no recorded footage from anyone making these claims. That one's probably a myth. What's not a myth, though, is the actual Trojan DS brick. This one's a little famous, actually. It was a Trojan designed as a ROM loader that, when ran, would destroy the firmware of the DS. And once it did, a brick wall would be displayed on the top screen, indicating that your DS was bricked. DS brick was inspired by PSP brick, a piece of malware that did the same thing for the PSP. But it didn't get talked about nearly as much as DS brick. If I had to guess why, it's because of firmware updates. While the PSP received firmware updates that were constantly patching these sort of vulnerabilities, meaning PSP brick didn't work anymore, the DS's firmware was basically locked in place. Games couldn't update it, and if something went terribly wrong and the firmware needed to be replaced, it needed to be sent out to Nintendo themselves in order to fix it. Essentially, I think what made DS brick so interesting to people was the idea that this could happen to anybody's DS if they were just looking for free games. However, in typical Tech Rules fashion, I have to ruin the fun. That's not something that happened. DS brick on its own does not have the power to brick your DS like this. Like many instances of malware, it needed a lot of help from the user to trigger its payload. This requires a little explanation, but bear with me. A simple DS card was made, typically called PassMe, that just exists to boot whatever's in slot 2 in DS mode instead of GBA mode, allowing genuine DS homebrew and games to be executed from repurposed GBA flashcards. However, what if you decided using PassMe to boot into homebrew all the time was inconvenient? Well, then you use the solution specifically designed for this reason, FlashMe. FlashMe replaces the DS's stock firmware and allows you to immediately boot into your slot 2 homebrew without even going through the DS menu first. To get it for yourself, you simply boot up the installer using the PassMe method. Yes, you still need PassMe to render PassMe obsolete, and this is where the firmware tampering happens. To do so, you literally have to open the battery cover on your DS and insert a small object around here. The goal is to short a point back here that allows the DS's firmware to be overwritten. This has to stay shorted for the entire process of installation. The moment the short stops, the firmware locks back up. It's also kind of dangerous, actually. There's a bunch of connections next to this point you can accidentally make. If you're only somewhat unlucky, you might trigger a system shutdown. And if the firmware installation was in its early stages, that might be a brick. You could also just blow a fuse. That one's definitely a brick. Now, why did I explain all of this instead of just mentioning the shorting thing? Well, the real answer is I find it really interesting and I never learned how to shut up. But the excuse I'm going to give you is I'm trying to show you how much work is required to install FlashMe. All of that is effectively for saving a few seconds on the menu. This is not something that your average pirate is going to need. FlashMe was more so designed for homebrew developers, ROM hackers, power users, the kind of people that have a specific reason to see that menu much more often than normal users. In other words, the very same people that I hope would know better than to run random software uploaded by some no-name. Of course, if you've been around console modding scenes before, you also know that pirates can be weird. They sometimes just blindly install and try to run whatever they can find without any regard to what it does or what it's for, just kind of hoping they somehow enable piracy on the way. Unfortunately, I could easily see someone failing to understand exactly how to pirate games, eventually somehow deciding they need to install FlashMe, seeing a rando on an IRC channel give a ROM loader, and breaking their DS. Ironically, FlashMe had fail-safes in place to recover from this very scenario, but the kind of people who would have been victim to this probably don't have the necessary knowledge to do so, unfortunately. However, there's no reason a kind volunteer couldn't provide a helping hand, and maybe a small lecture on digital safety so it doesn't happen again. I just think it was a very isolated incident is all. It happened, but only to a small handful of people, definitely not the huge amount that news outlets were trying to imply at the time. On the other hand, Trojans like DS Brick and PSP Brick had shown us that we're reaching the point of no return in our journey of unreasonable destruction. By opening systems to firmware updates, the only thing standing between the system and a villain is whatever security the system put in place, the ones designed to prevent this exact thing from happening. And how well did that go? Well, we just have to look at the consoles that have appeared after this point in time. The Wii, the PS3, the 3DS, the Vita, although that one did take a while. And even more recent systems that I can't even talk about, because they were made by a company that thinks abusing copyright law as a form of censorship is okay. Point being, these are systems that have, in a way, lost their battle with the modding community during their lifespans. They didn't lose to people trying to do the dumb stuff we're doing, though. These vulnerabilities are a direct result of trying everything in their power to avoid custom code in homebrew. The idea was to prevent piracy, but by preventing homebrew of any kind, they got the attention of extremely clever hobbyists who now have a reason to look for security vulnerabilities outside of a simple bug bounty. Because of this, piracy was an inevitability, even if they did delay it to varying degrees. However, with the defeat of the system's security, the door is left wide open for malware. And malware happened. Malware with the ability to brick systems and render them unusable. On top of that, there was one notable demonstration at DEF CON 18 where hackers literally took the Nintendo Wii and made it a Trojan horse that could literally be placed in a workplace to steal sensitive data, since nobody expects video games to compromise your security. Unfortunately, however, the only footage I can ever find of it are these small clips from Dean Takahashi, and that drives me crazy. Where's the rest of it? But, spoiler, if a place you work at with a supposedly secure network lets you connect a game system, they don't care nearly as much about security as they would like you to believe. Sad thing is, malware usually wasn't even necessary to cause problems. All it took was not following a modding tutorial closely enough, or thinking that you didn't need to make a backup until it was too late, and you end up with a system bricked beyond repair. Please make backups, by the way. And with the introduction of online shops, there's also technically a risk of intercepting credit card information, but those typically aren't stored on the systems themselves. At least they shouldn't be. I guess you could throw together some sort of keylogger, but something running in the background like that is a little harder to pull off. I want to make that really clear so that nobody thinks I'm teaching anyone how to commit theft. Targeting consoles is not an efficient or realistic method of theft. But yeah, as far as the systems themselves, major potential for malware. You'd think that would make the rest of this video far less interesting, but the modern age of gaming also brings us online gaming, and the concept of remotely messing with people without the need to touch a system in the first place. That's right, I'm talking about Minecraft griefing. Nah, but imagine if that was the build-up the entire time for this video. We're actually talking about your IP address. Yeah, the thing that those PSAs and friends and all those ads tell you to keep hidden at all costs. If you're not familiar with how that works, you probably don't realize how easy to grab that is. For example, if you're doing something as simple as playing a Call of Duty game or any game that utilizes a direct peer-to-peer connection, the host can figure out your public IP fairly easy. It's not a private thing. This can lead to a DDoS, which is a network debilitating term most gamers are probably familiar with and worry about these days. Or in the extremely improbable scenario, you say the wrong words to someone who actually knows what they're doing, they could take advantage of a poorly configured network to cause actual security concerns, like stolen information. I'll tell you a secret though, if somebody knows how to do that, they're probably not spending their free time compromising some random dude who got mad and started screaming at them. Oh, I should mention MMOs too. Those are fun. Since they're inherently always online, finding some sort of way to target the server itself would cause the game to go down for literally everyone. Granted, these servers are built to survive whatever you throw at them, so brute force isn't gonna cut it. You're gonna have to spend some time looking for a real vulnerability that may or may not exist. Or, alternatively, you go fishing. Yeah, in Final Fantasy XIV, A Realm Reborn, there was an incident where servers were sporadically crashing. It got fixed, of course, but the developers later revealed that the cause of the incident was fishing in a very specific spot. Yeah, all you had to do was fish in that spot, and you'd stop player progress so hard that it makes Raubon look like chopped liver in comparison. So if your server ever crashes and everyone starts accusing everyone else of fishing, now you know why. If I ever have a reason to do Tech Rules merch, I'm gonna make a hat that says "Fish want me, servers fear me." It will make one sale ever, but on the bright side, I'll be very happy with my purchase. Anyway, this is how most people would be malicious in MMOs. Just exploit some sort of in-game mechanic to ruin the fun of everyone else. Whether it was something as simple as denying players of the quest drop they need, or something more specific, like intentionally pulling enemies to the entrance of Crawler's Nest, it happens in every game. Although I'd imagine the most famous example would be World of Warcraft's Corrupted Blood incident, yeah? Pretty much anyone who played WoW around that time, or even today, knows about this one. A recently released raid boss had a simple mechanic. You're inflicted with something called Corrupted Blood that quickly drains your health, and you have to get away from everyone else to avoid giving the debuff to other people. That was it. The problem came from pets being infected by Corrupted Blood and then recalled. As long as the player could survive the rest of the raid, they were free to return to the major areas of the game with Corrupted Blood still active on their pet. From there, an infected pet released in a populated area would infect everybody nearby, leading to widespread chaos. This debuff was designed for a max level raid, so a low level player contracting this debuff would die in seconds. Even NPCs could get this thing, and you wouldn't even realize it until you got too close. It got to the point where some major cities had to be avoided until the issue was finally patched. Seems familiar, but YouTube's ad suitability system has informed me that I'm not sure why. However, that catches us up to the current day. While a lot of it wasn't intentionally malicious, I still think it's surprising how often these seemingly normal circumstances would lead to the loss of time, data, or even property, really. It makes our idea of throwing together malware in a meaningful way difficult. Yeah, it's not too hard to target a system that's already been modded, but not only is that just taking advantage of dangers the users already put themselves in, it's not even particularly interesting, nor would it really take anyone by surprise. So I figured if we were gonna do this, it would need to be something that would be reasonably destructive in a way that nobody would expect on a system nobody was worried about. So I went back and brainstormed with the older systems, since we basically had nothing in that era. Messing with the BIOS was obviously a no-go, since it's not designed to be tampered with conventionally, and tricking someone into installing a mod chip or something kind of misses the point of what we're trying to do. Might as well tell them to put it in a microwave to unlock blast processing or something. Sega does what reactivity does. And it'd be even easier to put Windows malware on a disk and tell the user to put it directly in their PC for free goodies, but that's kinda cheating. Also, it already happened with an Atelier game on the Dreamcast. The bonus PC wallpapers got infected with something that the developer's network had picked up at some point, or something like that. I think our best bet is trying to destroy a game, like with the Animal Crossing thing. Issue is, we don't have the luxuries the DS has here, and the carts are still too self-contained. So what if we looked over every system that used some form of media besides a cart? And after looking through, I don't remember how many obscure and weird systems, I found my answer in a device I've been overlooking this entire time. The Famicom Disk System. That weird peripheral for the NES's original Japanese counterpart that never ended up leaving the region. It allowed the Famicom to play games from a derivative of Mitsumi's Quick Disks. Playing games from these disks would allow you to take advantage of cheaper games, thanks to the storage medium. And better audio thanks to an extra sound channel. However, it initially caught my attention when I was looking at how each system saves their games. I figured the disk system would have some form of SRAM implementation, but nope. Turns out the save data is placed directly on the disk. My initial response to this was something along the lines of, huh? The idea of these disks not being entirely read-only was very surprising to me. I was just surprised that was the case for every single disk. It doesn't sound correct. I spent hours searching for evidence that it wasn't the case and found nothing. So, theoretically, you could take a retail game you didn't want to play anymore, go to a kiosk, and replace it with a completely different game. I don't know if it was officially allowed, but it was doable. And the disk system's method of saving meant that it's capable of overwriting these disks. You know what I want to do, right? But to enact this plan, we need to know exactly how much of the disk system can write to. If it's able to write to part of the disk, you would imagine it could write to all of it, right? The answer is yes, it can. Later revisions have a couple of measures in place to restrict how much it can write, but versions exist that can, out of the box, write to everything. If we could just somehow execute custom code on this thing, we could wipe entire games right off the disks they're stored in. So what do we have to work with? We have this part, the RAM adapter that goes into the Famicom's game slot. I guess we could put a pass-through device in there somewhere that modifies the data. It would kind of be a miracle if we made that work, and even if it did, we're just not getting people to use such a dumb device. We also have this port. I don't know what it does. No game's ever used it. I would guess it's some sort of expansion port that allows peripherals to send or receive some form of data. I literally could not figure this one out, and I highly doubt any code's gonna run off this thing in the first place. I don't think there's any way around this. If we wanna run code, we're gonna have to do it from the actual disk slot. But I brainstormed for a bit, thinking of how I could take the knowledge of today and apply it to a different time. And I think that restriction will be just fine. In fact, it may be the ideal way to set our trap. What if we utilized ROM hacks? We take an already existing, popular game and secretly mod in a new feature, one that supposedly allows you to bring exclusive items or content to other popular games. All you'd have to do is select the feature and switch to the other game. I've done as much research as I could on this, and I think it'd work. There's already a disk swapping feature used for large games, so there's no reason we can't store this malicious code into the disk system's RAM and run it when the disk is swapped. We could even make our own ROM hack self-destruct afterward if we wanted. This may seem like something nobody would fall for, but keep in mind we'd be attempting this in 1986. The World Wide Web only started being used by consumers in the super early 90s or something like that. Wouldn't it just be more likely that you somehow found a secret feature nobody else knows about, or there was some sort of expansion to the game that's been out for a while? Again, social engineering goes a lot farther than clever coding sometimes. If it turns out this method works, then how do we actually get our ROM hacks into the hands of unsuspecting consumers? Well, that's easy. We just, once again, take advantage of the fact that retail games are rewritable. We rent out the game that we made the ROM hack for, overwrite... When was the video game rental ban? 1984. Okay, so maybe not rentals. That takes the wind out of my sails just a little bit, but we can still presumably buy a game, overwrite it with the ROM hack, and then wrap it back up all nice and return it. That would work, right? Or at least drop it off at a store that sells pre-owned games. I don't know. Believe it or not, I don't know much about what went on in Japan before I was born. I'll commit reverse theft to make this happen if I need to. Theoretical reverse theft, but you know. It's a free name for your band, you're welcome. You'd think that not being able to do this on the disk system's most common revisions would be a bad thing, but there are some upsides to it. Since it targets a much smaller amount of people, there's a much larger chance that their story would be passed off as made up by others. And the units that are vulnerable to this belong to the people who have had their system the longest, meaning they've probably accumulated the most to lose here. Don't get me wrong, it would be a miracle if everything lined up properly to make this work. Even if all the research I did on this was accurate, most of which had to do with documentation that was not in English, it's still very easy for some simple quirk of the system to throw this entire plan apart. And it's not like I could throw together something to check either. Even if you had a lot of experience with writing NES games, there doesn't seem to be a lot of documentation for the disk system. And even with the information, that's not a weekend project. But hey, that means it's that much harder to prove me wrong. Anyway, if you know more about this stuff than I do, feel free to go in the comments and prove me wrong. I refuse to believe that this plan, as petty as it is, could work that smoothly. But I think that's enough being hypothetically evil for one day. If anything, we should be glad that such few attempts were made to target people just wanting to unwind with a fun game. Granted, we now have people willingly ruining their lives for virtual currency and gacha games, again, social engineering, but the alternative we talked about here had the potential to be so much worse. In a way, I'm glad I didn't have more to talk about here, even if I do think it's extremely interesting. I digress, though. For now, I hope you enjoyed this retrospective on console malware, and as always, I hope you keep an eye out for more tech rules.